is really to understand their concept of leadership and governance at Apex COVID. If I remember it correctly, also this time we're talking about a second or third iteration of the project itself. So we will, I mean, this is their agenda, so recap on the first workshop, highlights of the challenges, the discussion about the concepts of pods, nests, and wise owls, and then the confirmation of the next step. So, of course, they had their workshop to understand what is good. So, what is good for a DAO? What is good for the leadership and cooperation at IndexCop? Okay, so this is totally specific to their project. So, as you can see, autonomy, iteration, vision for the future, so on and so forth. And they had their really interesting workshop, and they established these 10 core decision-making truths. And I think we should go through them one by one, so that we might find something that is interest for ourselves and for our project and for what we're looking for. So the first one, decision-making process must be clear and transparent. And I think that this is a really important point, and I think this is also the reason why it is the first. So also here, how the decision-making process looks like, how things are decided, how things are done, has to be clear. It has to be absolutely undisputable how things are decided solution, to see if there is something that that layman or people that are not so deep into the topic might see that you might have overlooked. But the decision making should be taken by people that are delegated to take this decision, which are experts in a certain field. Point number five here, decision making structures should support diversity and inclusivity. It's 2022, I think we do not have to go too deep into this point. So of course there was this list of internet rules, so the rules of the internet, and I think one of them was written like there are no girls on the internet, which does not mean that there are no women on the internet or any kind of other person here or gender or whatever we want to call it. It means that everyone is equal, so there is no favoritism because you are one gender or the other, or whatever kind of gender you would like to or you define yourself, but everyone is equal. Back in the day it was really hard to have voice conversations, so it was all and mostly text, and therefore your ideas were taken as you put them. Nobody knew if you were Italian, German, Australian, New Zealander, whatever. Nobody knew who you were. Nobody knew your religion, your skin color, your gender. They didn't care. You could even, there is a meme that says, on the internet nobody knows that you are a dog. Because the important things are the ideas. The important things are the proposals, the initiatives, and again, how to bring a organization forward towards their goal and their mission. And so, point number five, pretty clear. Decision-making structures should support diversity and inclusivity. Point number six, the leadership and governance structure should promote an environment of safety and trust. Of course, when we talk about cryptocurrency and crypto technology, crypto-like crypto tokens and not crypto-like cryptography, even though they cross the path. Trust is a given. I mean, Bitcoin is still the biggest, I think, experiment and the biggest technology that showed how trusting the code revolutionized the world, because we are now here 13 years after talking about it and having all this discussion because Bitcoin was brought into the world, and therefore trust is what it, let's say, decentralized, and it puts trust into code. And of course safety, so I'm having these discussions also with our moderators from time to time, and we are with our teams figuring out how to make also the Discord, which is our community's main platform to meet, a safe space, which does not mean that sarcasm or some baiting and some discording. I mean, the platform itself is called Discord, alright, so we Discord with our ideas sometimes, and so it should be possible to have an opportunity to just let go a little bit when you feel frustrated, but still the majority of the platform should be a safe space where anybody feels welcome, where when you join and you ask a question, you get an answer instead of being showed the door, where if you go, if you come to the community and you propose your idea, there is nobody that just points a finger and says what you're doing is bullshit, because maybe you are working on this now for 8 months and for you it's a great idea, and it's the way people bring their criticism that changes things. And it should be a safe space where people have space to discuss, have space to discord, but toxicity should be left out of the following me now for the sixth or seventh evening heard it surely. So when there is a decision, well, the organization, the DAO, the governance structure, the people involved decided for one solution instead of the other. And at this point, everyone that was, let's say, against it has different options, but the most productive one is to effectively disagree, so say, okay, I disagree with the proposal, but still, let's push forward, and let's try this direction, because maybe I could have been wrong, or maybe it will show that I was right, but nobody cares. We now decided for this, the governance system, the people voting, whatever, and however it has been set up, decided for this, and now we go this way together, and we give our best to do so, which is the hardest part of it, because people might not be as motivated because it's not what they were voting and rooting for, but here is where maturity and growth really happens really strongly. Point number eight, which is also really strong iteration of what we said in the past, decision-making structure should help identify and move towards a clear vision for the future. The DAO organization, the group, and even more so the governance and the decision-making is towards the mission of the DAO, is towards the mission of the governance structure, of the leadership, of people making proposal, of everyone participating, and this is where a clear vision is absolutely important. Point number nine is the one that I love the most and which is becoming harder and harder with time, but it is important nonetheless that you have to iterate, you have to experiment, and only so you can improve. Yes, there are processes that work now since 1,000 years, well, they might not be the right ones. We should be free to experiment and to have the opportunity to fail and then to improve, because without failure there is no improvement, without failure there is no acknowledgement that probably the path that is being followed is not the right one, and if you would not have tried it, you would not have really known it, and therefore there is no improvement. So it is important to iterate, try things out, experiment, try new things, learn from the mistakes, and improve from there. And last but not least, to maximize contributors' autonomy, so to make sure that the contributors are autonomous. And again, these are the 10 core decision-making truths for Index. So take the good things of this, take the ones that resonate with you, and bring them to your ideas, and then mix them into your governance structure. And I think that this one here is also a really important comment. Getting the right people to make the calls, but anyone can be the right person. Alright, so you should give opportunities to people to try and get out of their comfort zone, because they might have the necessary amount of creativity to find a solution that has not been known before, or maybe they might have the expertise but not the ability to express it, and therefore anyone can really be the right person. So here you can see that the structure has failed, so I think this is where they are proposing version number 2 of the governance structure, and I think this is the path that brought the Index Corp to where they are at now. So these are important learnings. I think these are improvement proposals, Index improvement proposals. So this is what we have as tips, Tango improvement proposals, and I suppose these are Index improvement proposals. Now I think I got it.
I have a tip to share.
Yes, please.
Primarily on anyone can be the right person for the task, like something out of experience. So I have noticed that while having a vision, only being fixated on, you know, what needs to be accomplished is the best task, but how can always vary with what kind of experts we have. That way is it, like a lot of creativity can flow in. Thanks.
Kind of also really high trusted individuals which try to support the success of the broader area, which are then the pods around it. And so the pods are effectively the most important parts, as they are the teams which work in a really agile way with a specific area of focus. So they set the DAO up into these three different levels. And this is a really interesting concept, as it clearly states how things go and how things should be done, and it concentrates and focuses on certain parts. Of course, changing things is uncomfortable, so there might be there are usually breakups, and as we said yesterday, probably also forks or separation and let's say some breakings within the community, but that's just how life is. There is no way to always satisfy everyone. So how do they set up the pods? Pretty much clear, these are small teams around focused around one single expertise. So they go and set and separate, practically speaking, the core activities of the DAO, and there are these also here 6-7 people working specifically on that thing. And in this case, it's what we usually call a working group, and it is highly flexible, so that it is so that they focus, for example, here, all right, in a service-oriented DAO, they could be the investment team that takes the funds of the service DAO and figures out how to reinvest it by earning, by farming some tokens, buying NFTs, whatever. And they could meet, for example, with an HR pod, which takes care of figuring out which Web3 developers should be part of the roster of the service DAO, and they can work together and be part of a larger working group. So as you can see, it's 4, 5, 6, 7 people maximum working on a specific topic. In this way, it is agile, it is lean, they are not, let's say, disturbed by having too many discussions, and of course they are supervised, and they are given instructions on what they should be looking for, which might take them also the take away the responsibility or the workload of figuring out the strategy themselves. So it is some kind of people that get goals delegated to, or they might themselves propose their own goals, and those are then vetted by the wise owls, and when they're greenlit, they move towards that direction if it respects, let's say, the overall strategy. Here, of course, they have dynamic collaboration and experimentation. So here we see some examples: growth and marketing, video design, language, partnerships, designs, and they might work together with talent, operations, diversity groups, engineering, wizards, and analytics. They all work together one way or the other, but they're really focused in their own area. And the question is, okay, but of course it's great and it's nice to have something like that, but how do they get funded? And here is where their concept of nests come in. So every one of them is part of the nest, which take care of the funding, of the payments, of all things around coordination, accountability, and again verify the positive synergy towards KPIs and objectives. So here we pretty clearly see that it is important to remove some kind of burden from working groups and let the experts, let the people focus on what is important and support them with a broader infrastructure which takes care of bureaucratic stuff, for example. In this case, we might put it like this, so how to fund, how to verify KPIs, and so on and so forth. So here they showed how the actual structure changes, so there might be people becoming nest coordinators or pod leads and contributors, and so on and so forth. So here they have a more flexible model for leadership, which means that everyone can become a leader if they show a leadership, or they can then become nest coordinators. So again, everyone can in their time working with us, such organization, grow different skill sets, and you might see someone blossoming out of their possible let's say introvert lifestyle and actually have a leader coming out of that. And it should be leveraged, it should be given them the opportunity to show them what they're worth. They might fail, but still, you know, again, without failure there is no growth, so why not give them the opportunity to fail and to grow. But of course, in the end, it is all about reaching KPIs. So after a certain amount of failures, well, we try to remix the cards and verify if there are not other opportunities and so on and so forth. So here we have here how they set it up. So here is the various nests, how they call them, the various pods, how they are set up and divided, and so on and so forth. And here is this kind of process that they use for budgeting. So if you're interested in how they're doing it, just have a look at the resource, which is linked here. So it's this presentation here in the index cop section. And they have, of course, several challenges because the people's nest is done somewhere differently than a technical nest, and so on and so forth. So, as I said, just take your time to dig a little deeper into that, because there are 60 slides, so we're not going through them, totally not. We're just hitting another few important points here. Like, for example, what they define as their wise owls. So to see also this last part and how it is important for them also to delegate decision making. So the idea here is also that these wise owls are, in this case, temporary experiment group. So it would be great now after some time to see how it worked and if it worked, and to see how it moved forward. So here the biggest challenge and the biggest risk is not getting things done, and this is what happens when there's no agreement in disagreement. So people constantly say, no, my way is correct, or the other part says, no, my way is the correct one, and there is no no one giving in and saying, okay, let's just do this, and all right, let's just try, let's just do something, because that's one of the biggest risks that might happen, and it happens a lot, that people just get stuck into something and they say, okay, you know what, it is too much effort to continue discussing this, so we just stop discussing it and just throw it away after spending weeks on something, and it is not done, and you lost an opportunity to experiment, you lost an opportunity to try something out, you lost the opportunity to fail and to grow. And this is one of the biggest challenges here in the governance sector to just take a decision sometime and to have the opportunity to fail. It is impossible to do everything right. What also happened is that the contributors did not feel empowered. So, as you can imagine, if you're contributing to a DAO, if you're investing your free time into something and you're not having the opportunity to grow, it makes things really hard. It makes things unsustainable in the long term, because people just go somewhere else where they can or where they are empowered, which is pretty clear. The Wise Owls are tasked with proposing solutions to big decisions, which currently lack a clear owner, so they become DRIs, directly responsible individuals, and they take care of that. And of course, part of the solution is identify who and what will be responsible for making this decision going forward. So they decide then whom to delegate things to. And this is where they give then the opportunity to others within groups to become nest leaders and so on. So here, of course, they have a really nice decision flow where they say, okay, we start with a decision which lacks a clear owner and so on and so forth. I'm not going through this right now, first because I think it's not completely readable on my shared screen, and on the other hand because this should be read with time. And here, of course, they have a framework for electing wise owls. So this is really interesting. They set in the terms. Then they have continue, refresh, disband, specific responsibility, community poll calling for actions for support or an improvement proposal for support. So here they also try to clarify how it works. And then they have also this kind of weight, so depending on certain parameters. Again, they try really to explain clearly how things are going to happen moving forward. And also here the improvement proposals, I suppose, which this is. A sweet point and a sweet way to pose it. Investors do not want to vote on every operational decision, which makes sense. You should not overwhelm your DAO members with things like which color we should put this button. Someone should decide it. The contributors should make decisions and gain the trust to regulate, and you can change things if it's really, really not working. And here they use their proposal process for some decisions. So for example, validate specific delegated responsibility, confirming coordinators, confirming mass proposals and budgets. So they separate, they removed, or they divided certain decisions and said, okay, these decisions are going to be made in a pod, and we trust them, and we empower them, and we make it possible for them to move forward in this direction, and we still keep the improvement proposals for certain things. And this makes sense. This makes total sense. A DAO should propose ways of taking decision making to the next level, where there's not one person deciding it, where there's not one leader, one CEO playing dictator, but still it should be a way to give people empowerment and trust to take decisions and move forward towards a vision. And here it's pretty clear. They are accountable. If there's something that's not working, hey, you're going to be replaced, no worries. You can work on something else if it's necessary. There are many different options and opportunities within a DAO within an organization. So there should be given also second and third chances to people, maybe after they grow within a certain or a different area of responsibility. So here they define, oh my god, I love tables. They define how it works and who should take decisions. So it is pretty clear set up, and I think there is somewhere really nice Google Docs, which we are not going to look into. But again, they are defining a list of decision-making responsibilities in their constitution of their DAO, of their organization, which is key for them, of course. So also here, take what is important and what can be interesting for you. And then they want to push the index COP from a algorithmic or between algorithmic and open community to a more open and council sub DAO organization, which makes it contributor led organization, so more bottom up instead top to bottom. And here they show where everything is in line with the core decision making truths that they defined by themselves. So as you can see, what are the many different points here? The many different points is that there is a necessity by the DAO to have entrepreneurs, to have people that are there to contribute, of course, but they have also have to have the power to take decisions, to lead certain initiatives, to make proposals, to vote. Do not take people for granted. Do not relegate them to being just someone you show your work and say, okay, do you like it or not? Yes or no? No, who cares? I'm going my way anyway. Try to give them space to grow, give them space to contribute, to take key decisions, of course, with time, with trust. I mean, it's not something that every newcomer should do. There is a path for newcomers in every DAO, in every open source project, where you start building the trust and your reputation first. And from there, either you bring in very nice portfolio of what you have done so far, or you start from the bottom and you work your way up. And this is how it works. And it has to be defined, it has to be clear, it has to be transparent, people have to be accountable. It is important to be able to disagree and commit. It is important to experiment and to improve and to maximize, as they define point number 10, contributors' autonomy. And this is a very big thing, in the sense of that this is an endeavor that takes time, should not be taken lightheartedly, but should also not be overthought. I mean, if it's 5 people in your DAO, if it's 10 people in your DAO, let's take it easy. The more you grow, the more external people start joining, the more processes you have to start to think about and implement into your DAO to make things clear, to make things transparent, make people accountable for their decisions, to define how to reach goals, to remove stones from your path, to find solutions. And it is an effort, and it is a really high effort, but it pays off in the long term. And of course, you can set up a DAO with 2 friends, and that's it. We take some decisions on chain just for the fun of it, or to be transparent with everything. Yes, that works too. There is nothing against it. There is no perfect model. There is no perfect solution. There is a pool of transparent experience in organizations, in DAOs out there that we can now tap into and learn from and try to find the best possible solution for my kind of structure, for our needs at that point in time. And they will change with time as you grow, or as the ecosystem around you changes. So do not fixate on a certain leadership model. Do not fixate on a certain governance model. Iterate, change, try, experiment, and give also the organization the time to adapt. So do not expect things to change within 2 weeks or a month, because it takes at least 3 months for people to even understand what all the changes are. So give also the organization the time to change and to figure out what works and what not, and then restart iterating. And this is how they started doing it. So here is, they had 3 days of elections, confirmation, and 4 days after that they started doing. So they started here, and as you can see from the nests, so here we have 19th of November, December, end of January, so 2 months to set up the nests, and then they started going forward. Now it would be interesting, of course, now here's some chill chat and appendixes and other interesting slides from their presentation. The thing is, also here, really important, it takes time, and even more so, a structure that has been defined and worked in a certain way, it takes even more so to change and break the old system and bring in the new. Alright, so I think we went through the most important things of this example, of this case of a DAO. Any questions, any contributions someone would like to bring to the group? As always, you can either write in the channel or unmute yourself and just speak up.
Hi, Antonio. Thanks for presenting this. You mentioned KPIs as a possible way to gauge contributors' performance. I've read some things that are kind of critical of using KPIs as a metric. Do you have any good examples of some that might be useful to us?
KPIs have, of course, to be defined based on your strategy. So what we as IOTA Foundation are shifted to now for some time is OKRs. So the goal, let's say the idea is always the same. You have to have something that is measurable one way or the other. There is no way around that. The idea here is to, let's say, not measure performance, but make sure the goals are reached. It is not important if you work at 9 to 5, if you work at night. Nobody cares. What cares is that you reach a certain goal. And I think that OKRs are a very good example about how to do that. I don't know if you ever heard of objective and key results framework. But the idea is more or less this, that you set yourself an objective which should not really be totally reachable, as crazy as it sounds. So what is it? What is Dom's goal? We want to reach 250,000 addresses by the end of the year or something like that. So this is an objective. I want something that is possibly out of reach, but I want to work towards that objective. And to reach that objective, you set some kind of key results which are measurable. So, alright, I think that his objective actually would be to become the most active chain, or the most active non-chain in the space. And one of his key results is to have 250,000 active addresses. So the objective is really broad, is a vision you work towards to, and you break it down into things that you can measure. For example, we want to have the most active community in the crypto space. All right, this is an objective. This is something that is not totally graspable, but it gives an idea what you want to reach. And then we decide, okay, one of our key results could be to have at least 3 meetings per week in our channels with at least 15 participants. we want to organize another DAO Pioneer session with which goes 3 weeks and pull that through. That is really measurable because you have to do that. And it is not about macromanaging, so it's not about, oh, Antonio, did you prepare the presentation? Oh, Antonio, or oh, Philo, did you set up the documents? Is the infrastructure running? No. The tasks, you set them up in your daily thing, but as a group, as a team, you define these objectives and key results for a quarter, for 6 months, or whatnot. So I think, which one was it? There are many, many different books, of course. Measure what matters. I think it is, yes. This is, I think, the What Matters page, and they have also a, here it is, Measure What Matters. This is a really good book by John Doerr about OKRs. So if you find the digital version of it, I suggest to read through it, because this is one of the other ways of making people accountable for reaching or not reaching the objectives. And again, as I said before, the objectives should not be totally reachable. So you should be able to reach around 60-70% of your objective, because if it's reachable, well, then it was not challenging. And if it's totally unreachable, well, you probably set your objective wrong. So if you are able to achieve only 10%, well, probably your objective was not defined properly. And if you reach 120% of your objective, then it was too easy. And if it's too easy, it's not motivating enough, because the idea is to make it far enough that you have the feeling that you can grasp it, but that motivates you to continuously contribute and continuously work on the objective. Does it, Rob, did it give you some kind of idea of what I'm talking about, or was I too fuzzy with my logic?
No, it helped a lot. I actually am not familiar with OKRs. I'll have to look into that, but it makes sense. I mean, I think that's kind of where I was getting with it, is just setting the goals and then finding good ways to measure progress.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So usually you set one goal per, or 1, 2, 3 goals per quarter. 1, 2, 3 objectives per quarter, and every objective should again have between, I think, 3 and 5 key results which are measurable. And there you can then figure out, have these key results been reached? Yes, no, why not? So there is then a feedback round to understand what did not work, which sometimes is, I set a key result which is dependent from someone else. This is one of the traps. You should be careful when you set objectives and key results. Everything should be reachable by you or by your team independently from others. So for example, if I would set an objective which is called find 15 people that want to make meetups around Shimmer by August, and I'm dependent on the Shimmer release where we have an internal ETA but not public ETA, I might fail because I do depend on someone else, and they might during their work actually have a blocker. I don't know, you know, they could meet somewhere and all get corona and be sick for 2 weeks, and I cannot reach my key result. So I did something wrong, and this wrongdoings or these errors, they come out during a feedback round. So it should not be a way of punishing your contributors or your employees, if we talk about a company in the standard sense of the idea, but it should be a way of motivating people to reach things. It should be a track record of what they have been able to reach. It should be a way for the organization to organize in such a way that things move forward and that people are empowered to do so, and to motivate people to continuously pushing. and also to optimize processes in a very agile way, because within one quarter and the other you can change strategy really quickly. While if you set KPIs for the whole year, and like in the last 2 years you had a pandemic and things change radically, you will not be able to work for the next 9 months, and there is no discussion of the goals. While if you work quarter by quarter, it is pretty agile to change your objectives and key results towards a completely different direction after one quarter. Yeah.
Thank you.
All right. I hope, yeah, I mean, my logic is pretty fuzzy. I'm sorry for that. But I'm trying to also bring some personal experience into this. I don't know if it sounds like that, but it is totally like that.
No, it helped a lot. Thank you.
All right. Awesome. So I can share, of course, the link of the book. I mean, it's not mine, so I'm not getting any kind of money out of this. So if anyone is interested, but of course, there are free resources out there. So take the time to look into this in your spare time and to figure out how it works and how to get there. All right, thank you for the question. Anyone else would like to contribute, ask questions or add anything? If not, I thank everyone again for participating today in our learning session. General reminder, we have tomorrow the recap with Holger, with Philo, at 3 p.m. CEST, which will be done on Twitter Spaces and then streamed into Discord, which is an experiment from our side to try to break the bubble and to reach other people on Twitter, which might be interested in DAOs in general, and then maybe grow some curiosity towards what we do as a community and ecosystem. So I hope that you join us for tomorrow. And for our European Learning Group, we meet for our last week, week number 3, on Tuesday, next week, the 14th, where we will meet 14th, 15th, and 16th for our third and last week of this season of the DAO Pioneers. So thanks again, everyone, for contributing, for your inputs, for your questions, and I hope to see you tomorrow. Thanks again. And have a
Thank you.
Thanks.
Bye.
Cheerio. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.